And they were on the road going up to Jerusalem, and Jesus was walking ahead of them. And they were amazed, and those who followed were afraid. And taking the 12 again, he began to tell them what was to happen to him, saying, "See, we are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and the scribes, and they will condemn him to death and deliver him over to the Gentiles."
I like pictures. I told you, I like cartoons, especially because they're drawings. Genesis begins with the description of the creation. And if you've ever noticed, when it talks about the plants, you know, it's kind of out of the blue. There's no blueprint. Did you notice that? There's no blueprint. It doesn't go, "And he made the flowers because they kind of look alike." Or, "They made the flowers and they were the image of this." This morning there's a little one, and I've been so excited. Shana knows this. If there's a little child making noise, I get really excited. Mainly because it sounds about right. Because we could learn a whole lot from that. Because you know what? When Jesus spoke about the kingdom of heaven and who it really belonged to, little children. And when we think about the image of God, man. We have such an issue with images here that it's kind of funny. But the problem is, unless we burn our faces off, we will always have images before us. And looking throughout history, this is one of those famous images throughout history. This is Jesus the Propetrator. My Latin is terrible. But in the middle you have this picture. And it's supposed to represent Christ, but it's not like they're trying to look like Christ. It's actually just two halves. This picture is actually two halves put together. If you notice, his face looks really rough on this side and really nice on this side. And so what they did is they cut the image in half, put a mirror to it, and then they figured out what this image really was. This image is really two images put together. And what it was, the whole point was to represent is that there is Jesus. There is God. And if we ever separate the two, the Bible ceases to make sense. If he's only Jesus, then he can die. He can serve people. He could be a prophet and work miracles. No issue there. He could do many of the things he did if he's Jesus. But if he's God, he can do things that no one else can do. Because there are no savior outside of God. God is the only one who can save anyone. He is the only one who, in his perfection, can cleanse everyone through his blood. Only in Christ do we have our King and our God, but only in Jesus do we have the rest of the story. Because we can't kill God. But the important thing is that Jesus came out and said it, and the scripture reading was this: they're going to kill him. The man, the human side of God, will die and be raised. The human side. And so he says this to them, and you would think that on seeing this, they begin to understand the human side of God. The human that, as a symbol of a talent. The human that, in this, is shown blessing people. And yet when he says that he's going to die, they don't respond correctly. Today we are in Mark chapter 10. But we start in verse 35. "And James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came up to him and said to him, 'Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask of you. And he said to them, what do you want me to do for you? And they said to him, grant us to sit one at your right hand and one at your left hand in your glory. Jesus said to them, you do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink, or to be baptized with the baptism with which I am baptized? And they said to him, we are able. And Jesus said to them, the cup that I drink, you will drink. And with the baptism with which I am baptized, you will be baptized. And they said to him, we are able. And yet we understand these way different. They're thinking of a cup. The cup of blessing, right? Jews are always coming to the cup of blessing. Baptism. They're thinking back to either John's baptism, the baptism that Jews use for conversion. They're not thinking about what Jesus just said. I'm about to drink a cup. I'm about to be baptized. Because the way that Jesus said it was, he says, you know, I will go and I will suffer and die. He doesn't say I'm going to drink a cup and then get baptized. And yet in this, he offers them that. He says, you know what? You can drink the same cup I'm going to drink. That same wrath of God that is poured out in bowls and cups in Exodus, in Revelation. That same suffering that the man, Christ Jesus, could take. That same baptism of death. Because as much as we think about baptism, and we use this image of Christ dying, being buried, and rising again, we don't always associate baptism with death. But yet in Scripture, baptism is always associated with a death. Whether the death of us or with Christ, it's the death of Him. And so he offers them this. He says, you can drink the cup that I give you. You can be baptized with the baptism that I'll be baptized with. And they say it. They're imagining this great kingdom, and he's imagining this great service. This great serving where he gives himself and is baptized after drinking the cup. And he continues this in verse 40. He says, but to sit at my right hand or at my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared. And when the 10 heard it, they began to be indignant at James and John. And Jesus called them to him and said to them, you know that those who are considered rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them, but it shall not be so among you. Whoever would be great among you must be your servant, and whoever would be first among you must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. Too often we've taken Christ and we've separated him and we've made him one side of what he is. We've taken him away and we've done generally what they're looking at, and they say, you know, when I get to heaven, you know, can you make me great? You're this king. And he offered them something beautiful in return. This story that we just described is one that it almost doesn't make sense to us, because in the first part, he says these things like cup in baptism, very negative. And in the second part, he says, you want to be great. And he says, and if we link it back to the stuff before, we link it back to that same cup and that same baptism. Because he says, those who will be greatest is a servant. And Jesus flip-flops everything. When we're in the Beatitudes, it is the best flip-flop you will ever see. He says, if you're poor, you're blessed. If you're suffering, you're blessed. If you give your life for God, you are blessed. And through that lens, we begin to see this, and he says, you really want to be great in the kingdom of God. Do you? Because he doesn't say in the kingdom of God everything is equal. He doesn't say that. He says, if you want to be great in the kingdom. And then he offers it and he says, if you want to be great in the kingdom of God, so that we know that in the kingdom, sorry, there is a distinction. But yet, in this kingdom, he says, let me tell you how you were greatest. Not that he hasn't already said it through the cup and the baptism. He's going to say it again, serve, serve, serve. He's going to say that in the kingdom of heaven, those which suffer for him will truly be blessed. They will be greater in the kingdom. Those who are baptized, as in they die, as in not the washing where we join with Christ, but the one where we're in Christ already and yet we're baptized. It's death. Baptism of death. Where we die as he died for him so that we can be martyrs and we can be great in the kingdom. And yet our Christianity is so far removed from that because guess what? We don't really have any good martyrs. We don't really have any great martyrs around. We are highly unlikely to ever get the chance to be martyred. And at first we're like, well, how great it is to be in a place where there's no risk of being martyred. I don't know, the opposite of what Christ said. How blessed is it to be in a place where we're engaging the world and we risk being martyred? Well, according to Christ, great. And according to Christ, he changes everything on its head, and the idea is it's a little difficult. Because we can't even figure out how Christ is God and yet servant. And we want to separate those two really, really far, but they're so entwined that it doesn't make sense because if we go back to God, he serves. Is it not our God who says that he changes to us? Our God who never changes, and yet we entreat him and he says, okay. We pray to him, and yet he moves. This God who is great and God and King, and yet says, okay, you want this? Okay, you may have it. And we see in the end, not only does Jesus teach this concept to them, not only does he teach it once to them very clearly, I'm going to die and rise again, get the point. They don't get it. Then they come to him with a question, and he takes their question to offer them something greater. Death. Death, and to be the highest you can be, to be a martyr. And then at the end, we see Jesus serving. And once again, being God. And servant at once. Verse 46. And they came to Jericho, and as he was leaving Jericho with his disciples and a great crowd, Bartimaeus, a blind beggar, the son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside. And when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. And many rebuked him, telling him to be silent. But he cried all the more, son of David, have mercy on me. And Jesus stopped and said, call him. And they called the blind man, saying to him, take heart, get up. He is calling you. And throwing off his cloak, he sprang up and came to Jesus. And Jesus said to him, what do you want me to do for you? And the blind man said to him, Rabbi, let me recover my sight. And Jesus said to him, go your way. Your faith has made you well. And immediately he recovered his sight and followed him on the way. He does it. Jesus does everything required for him to teach us. He tells us things, we get confused. He answers questions to help clarify what he just said. And then he comes to the end and just does it. And what do we see here? We see how great he is through his service. We see him doing what the disciples don't seem like they really wanted him to do. And many rebuked him, telling him to be silent. I mean, right? Because you don't want somebody pestering the Son of God. You don't want somebody just, you know, making noise around the Son of God, right? Those quiet disruptions that we probably should pay more attention to. Those little distractions that are probably just as important. I told you I got really excited for this lesson because there was a child in here making noises that we should have been listening to. Right? And what do? We gotta drown it out and focus on God because this is God. Shh! Silence! Shh! Stop it! Focus. Blinders on. We gotta go full horsepower right here, right? You don't notice anything around you. Come on. This is church. It really seems like that's what Jesus got into too. He's like, call that man. You mean that distraction over there? Yeah, call that man. The dude we've been correcting this whole time, telling him to stop. Yeah, that guy over there. Tell him to come on over. Tell him, tell that distraction, the one who dares cry out to God, dares disrupt the Son of God. And he calls him over. What do you want? What do you want me to do for you? Okay. That's it. And he does it. And we, honestly, if we had one of those pictures, I'm really comfortable with, I showed you that icon, because I'm comfortable with one side of it. I think it's called God with the Bible, you know? One side was seriously God with the Bible. It's just this stoic, like, actually looks, you know, pretty impressive. And the other guy looks like, I don't know, it's this slim, childlike face. And you're just like, okay, I wouldn't trust you. Yeah. And I'll be honest, that most of the time I think about God or Christ, we don't use images because, I don't know. They use them in the temple, they use them throughout the Bible, there's no reason not to. And yet we look at this and my image that I already have, because you have one too. When you think about God, you probably go one direction or the other. And for a lot of us here, our direction is, we've got this concept of God with this Bible and this gavel. I don't know, maybe some angels with some swords and stuff. Maybe. And we've got this idea of these blinders, and we're looking at God, and we come to, and it's like, nothing else matters. Instead of coming to God and everything else matters. We come to God, and it's, God, let me bring you some stuff. Drop it at the door, is what I've been told. How about I bring that to God instead? How about that thing that you said to leave behind me, I actually take in and say, God, I offer you my Sunday morning. I don't offer you 45 to 50 minutes. I'm going to offer you my life. I'm going to bring it all and offer it all to you. And not have these false images of God. Because when we want to be like Christ, it kind of matters what we think Christ looks like. It kind of matters if we imagine Christ as a super religious Pharisee, or if we imagine Christ as the servant of all. And if we imagine Christ as the servant of all, and we say, you know what, I really want to be a great Christian, what do I do? And I look to Christ and I say, what is the best thing I can do to be a great Christian? Well, die. There you go. I need to be persecuted, and I need to die. I want to be, because most of us would be honest, and we're not going to say, oh, I want to be a mediocre Christian. If I make it to the gates of heaven, and I get to hang out right beside the gate, I'm happy. We're not like that. We're like, we want to be in the front row. We want the, you know, the standing only room, you know, right there, you know. And we would say that. And then we'd go, well, but heaven, everything is neutral. And the problem is that it's not in the Bible. Someone just made it up because it was fun. What we have in heaven is we have greater and lesser. You want to be great in the kingdom of heaven? Here it is. But yet, when he tells you the price tag, you go, oh, maybe the gates are sounding pretty good right now. You know, when he tells you what you get is to be a martyr, to be that cloud of witnesses that surrounds us, that cloud of witnesses that joins us. When we worship, there's a cloud of witnesses that joins us, of these martyrs and saints that have gone before us. And these people, when we're offered the chance to join them, and we go, whoa, price tag's too high. I don't want to be a martyr. But we'll come to him and say, God, we want to be like you. The truth is, our Jesus, that we often miss out, is the Jesus of the town. The Jesus of Easter. The Jesus who suffers for us. And if we're reminded of that, then all the rest becomes very little cost. Because we would love to attack the apostles and say, you know what, they ask a question I would never ask. That's a lie. We all ask it, we just don't say it out loud. It's rude. We do. We're like, I want to be really important. And you know you're thinking it. Your mama told you were important. You believed her. Therefore, to this day, you're like, I want to be important. I have dreams. I want to be the Czar of America. They don't have that yet, but I'm working on it. And I have these dreams. But I can't say those out loud, because obviously that would be very prideful of me to say that. I just said it. But we do. We have these ambitions and goals. And honestly, they at least have this goal of, when I get to heaven, can I be great like you? Okay. That's, I'm better than I'm good. I want to be the Czar of America. They want to be just sitting at Christ's left and right hand, ruling with him over heaven. And at least they're thinking of spiritual terms. And he says, great. Let me tell you how to do it. And I'd love to say that's a step up. But getting to be a martyr is not really what it's about. Because before we ever begin, Christ gives us a warning. He said, if you love something more than me, you can't be my disciple. You can't be a Christian. So at the point we're struggling and going, like most of us would, and say, you know what? I don't want to die for Christ. Then we have to take it a step back. And a step back and say, is it because I love something more than God? And if I do, I'm not going to be hanging outside the gate. I'm going to stop at the gate. He's going to say, this is for those whose Lord was Christ. Not whose Lord was their life, or their family, or their possessions, but whose Lord is Christ, because we enter into his kingdom. So today we offer an invitation as close as we can get to Christ and say, if you're willing to give up everything, if you're ready to die for Christ, and ready to give anything for him to make him your Lord, then there's an invitation for you. If not, seek him until he makes it so. So today we offer an invitation for those who are ready to give their full life to God. To those who are willing to believe in him, to repent of your life as you know it, to confess him as your Lord, meaning that he is your Lord, to be buried with him in baptism so that you're raised up to live for him so that you can continue to serve him as Lord so you get to heaven and you just switch sides and then he's king already. He was when you walk through the gate, and he is once you walk past it. We offer that invitation. We offer an invitation of prayer. Because it is possible to fall from grace. And we offer the invitation to submit to the eldership here. If any of those apply to you, we ask you to come now as we stand.